Did you know of the four main ways in which the burning bush seen by Moses on Mount Horeb is a figure type of the Virgin Mary? Did you also know that the mountain itself is likewise considered a symbol of Our Lady? You're listening to Genesis 3:15. I will put enmities between thee and the woman, and thy seed and her seed. She shall crush thy head, and thou shalt lie in wait for her heel. I'm your hostess, Mariana Bartold, the author of Fatima, the Signs and Secrets, and Guadalupe, Secrets of the Image. Anyone who is even somewhat familiar with the Bible knows something about the history of Moses. In his life, he himself was a figure type for the coming Messiah. The mission given to him by God began after he saw the Lord in a burning bush, which was left unharmed. The church views this sign as a figure type of the Virgin Mary, of the Lord God dwelling within the Virgin Mary, and as a symbol of her charity, her humility, her perpetual virginity, and her immaculate heart. Let's explore why, but to do that, I must first briefly spotlight the prophet Moses. We know that Moses fled from Egypt and lived in the land of Midian, where he became a shepherd. Throughout his life, Moses was being prepared by God for his mission as prophet and deliverer of the Israelites, who were his own people and who had been, for 400 years, slaves in the land of Egypt. And finally, the day came when, on Mount Horeb, the Lord first appeared to Moses via the miraculous appearance of a bush which burned but was not consumed. As the book of Exodus chapter 3 relates, quote, "And Moses said, I will go and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he went forward to see, he called to him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he answered, Here I am. And he, meaning the Lord, said, Come not nigh hither. Put off the shoes from thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground." Unquote. To quote St. John Ude, "First, we should consider that the mountain on whose slopes the bush grew is called in sacred scripture the mountain of God. It is also spoken of as a holy mountain," and here the saint references Exodus 3, verse 5. "We shall easily be convinced, therefore, that it represents the Blessed Virgin Mary, who is the true mountain of God, a mountain of holiness, of whom we can well say with St. Gregory the Great that she is the mountain foretold by the prophet Isaiah as the peak towering above all other heights. For in Isaiah chapter 2, verse 3, he speaks of a mountain on the top of mountains, because God raised her in dignity, in sanctity, and in power above the chief seraphim and the greatest saints." Unquote. As we also know from divine revelation, charity is the highest virtue, which is another reason why the Mother of God is properly represented by the burning bush that was not burnt by the flames. For what better use could those flames of fire denote than the fire of charity, which was burning in Mary's heart? Hers was the ardent charity, which burns but does not consume. St. John Ude also says that, quote, "We ought not to despise this insignificant bush, a lowly shrub, the least of all plants. On the contrary, we should regard it with respect, since God so honored this bush as to choose it in preference to the tallest cedars of Lebanon for this manifestation of his glory amid the fire and the flames of its miraculous blaze. Would you know the reason for this? Listen to the Holy Ghost. The Lord is high and looketh on the low, and the high he knoweth afar off." And that is a quote from Psalm 137, verse 6. As the saint also explains, "It delights his providence to look with a kind and loving eye at that which is small and lowly." And as the saint continues, "Thus he was attracted to the humility of Mary, his handmaid." And St. Bernard speaks as follows of the profound humility of Mary's heart, quote, She, who in her own mind and heart was the least of all creatures, has rightly been made the first, because even though she was in fact the first, she considered herself as being the last. Unquote. God appeared to Moses not in a tall tree, but in a humble bush. In the fullness of time, the Son of God is born, not of a noble and exalted queen of this world, but of the humble Virgin Mary. From the earliest days of the Church, other saints recognize in the burning bush that was never consumed a figure type of the Mother of God. Among them are two born in the early 4th century, St. Epiphanius and St. Ephrem, the latter being a doctor of the Church, St. Augustine, born in the mid-4th century, he is another doctor of the Church, and St. John Damascene, also a doctor of the Church, he was born in the late 7th century. Now, by simply looking at only two comparisons, we can easily understand why these Church Fathers recognized and taught of this figure type of the Blessed Virgin Mary. In the time of Moses, the Lord rested in the burning bush without in any way harming its integrity. And in a similar manner, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who took from his Immaculate Mother his humanity, dwelled body and soul within her, all the while preserving her virginal integrity, body and soul. Tradition reveals that the Blessed Virgin consecrated herself to God by a vow of perpetual chastity. As we know, tradition and scripture are the only two sources of divine revelation. Hence, when the Archangel Gabriel announced to her that she had been chosen to become the mother of the Savior, tradition allows us to understand why she made that inquiry to the Archangel of, "How can this be, since I know not man?" Otherwise, Our Lady would have interpreted the Archangel's words to mean that she would become the mother of the Savior after her marriage to Joseph was consummated. But both she and Joseph knew that theirs would be a virginal marriage. And that is the reason why she asked the angel, "How can this be? For I know not man." And the angel, answering, said to her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Most High shall overshadow thee," as we see in Luke chapter 1, verse 35. With those words, the archangel explained to her that she would be both virgin and mother. Then was fulfilled that which the prophet Isaiah had foretold, saying, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son," as we see in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. As Gabriel the archangel told the virgin of her son, "The Holy, which shall be born of thee, shall be called the Son of God," Luke 1:35. Of the virginal incarnation of Christ, St. Jerome, doctor of the Church, says, "What nature cannot do, what custom has never known, what reason ignores, what the human mind cannot understand, what fills heaven with astonishment, the earth with wonder, and all the inhabitants of paradise with admiration, is by Gabriel announced to Mary on God's behalf, and is fulfilled by Christ. Saint Bernard remarks that if God was to be born in this world, it was becoming that he should be born of a virgin. And if a virgin was to bring forth, it was also befitting that she should bring forth no other but God. The Church also, in the Divine Office, teaches us to behold in the bush which burned without being consumed as an image, another word for figure type, of Mary's admirable and perpetual virginity, with these words, "The burning bush, which Moses saw unconsumed, is a figure of thy perpetual virginity, O Mother of God." This wonderful union of virginity and maternity in the Blessed Virgin is beautifully described in the ecclesiastical office in the following way. "A virgin has brought forth a king whose name is eternal. She has the joys of a mother with the honor of virginity. Never before was there one like unto her, neither shall there be another." Now, back to Moses. As we know, he was favored with this extraordinary vision of the burning bush because God willed to send him a mission, which means ascending. God was about to deliver his people from the slavery of Egypt. For the Lord said to him, "I have seen the affliction of my people in Egypt, and I have heard their cry. And knowing their sorrow, I am come down to deliver them out of the hands of the Egyptians." What does this bondage of the Israelites in Egypt represent but the human race groaning under the yoke of sin in the slavery of the devil? God saw the miserable condition of the children of men, and he heard their ardent prayers. To Moses, God came himself from the dwelling place of his glory, and he rested within the burning bush. As Moses said, this was a great sight. But when God sent the archangel Gabriel to the virgin, and she assented to God's will, we no longer see the figure type, but the archetype in reality and in truth. In the Annunciation of the Virgin, at which the incarnation of Jesus took place, the Holy Ghost overshadowed her, and the Lord revealed that the Son of God resting in Mary. As we can see in the burning bush that was not consumed, the prophecy of Genesis 3:15 and the general law of preparation continue to unfold in history in anticipation of the time in which in Jesus and Mary the figure types of the Old Testament were fulfilled and when the symbols of the Old Testament made way for the reality of the new. Finally, St. Thomas of Villanova, born in the mid-14th century, says that the bush which Moses saw entirely in flames without being consumed was really a symbol of the heart of Mary. Furthermore, what St. John Oud says of the burning bush, he also applies to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Quote, "It is obvious that God cherished a specially tender love for this little bush, that his heart was there, and that he took pleasure in it. He chose it to be his throne, the place where he would manifest his glory to his servant Moses, and where he would speak to his prophet, disclose divine secrets, and reveal his providential designs to deliver the chosen people from bondage." Unquote. When Moses beheld from a distance the miraculous bush, alight with flames yet not burning away, he was astonished, and he said, "I will go and see this great sight." As St. John Oud reminds us, God remained in the burning bush only a short time, but he has always been and will forever abide in the heart of our glorious Mother. Thank you for listening to today's episode. If you'd like to hear future installments, please do two simple things. First, like this broadcast, and second, subscribe to this channel, Genesis 315. Until the next time, may God bless you, and may Our Lady Mary keep you and yours under her starry mantle. Salve Regina.